Okay. Hi. Welcome everybody. I'm glad to see you. Wow, so a lot more people than so earlier. So my name is Ben. I'm the principal tutor of the Electronic Music Lab. I'm very happy to be invited by Chinmay and Sook to talk today about, and I came up with this topic, acousmatic music in the era of EDM and launchpads. Basically everything in the kitchen sink. Right? And if this sounds very academic, don't worry, it won't be. So first, because Ivan also advertised Creative Commons, I also must sell a bit of koyo. Okay? I'm here because I'm the principal tutor of the Electronic Music Lab. I'm also half of the band Cosmic Armchair, cosmicarmchair.com. We have 4 EPs out and 1 album coming out end of year. We'll be launching it in Tokyo in November. It's 2 gigs in Tokyo, together with the 10th anniversary of the Japanese indie band Cobalt Bomb Alpha Omega, which we are very happy to be at their 10th anniversary celebration to launch our album. So that's cosmicarmchair.com. If you like synth pop, electro pop, with a kind of like new wave 80s sound, cosmicarmchair.com. Okay? And as for Electronic Music Lab, we're a performance group based at NUS. Our members are from all over, that creates, performs, and produces and promotes original electronic music. And you can find out more at eml.org.sg. So if you are interested in watching electronic music performances, 8th October, you can mark it down in your calendar now. We have a whole day and night festival at NUS. eml.org.sg, you can find out where to get tickets from there. If you are interested in learning more about playing and performing electronic music, you're welcome to drop by on a Saturday morning at NUS. Again, details at eml.org.sg. And if you want us to perform at your event, drop us a note at that address as well. If you also want to license any of our musicians' work for your video production or whatever, you know, if you happen to have a video production house but you don't have the in-house musician like Ivan, then yeah, also available. Okay, reasonable rates. Okay, so this is the three of the students at the lab working on something. Okay, so we're talking about acousmatic music. And then what on earth is acousmatic music? First of all, before I do that, who here is familiar with acousmatic music, has listened to acousmatic music before? Okay, that's 4 more than I normally meet on any given day, right? So this is the technical definition of acousmatic music. It's electronic music composed for presentation using speakers, not live performance. And if you want to take the historic thing, it comes from Pierre Schaeffer's Music Concrete, right, in the 60s, where he developed music using tape splicing, which is a lot of fun. I actually studied it for a while, tape splicing, and putting tapes backward and sticking them together with scotch tape. You know, it's fun. And doing all kinds of processing which could not be played live by human beings. So how do you present it? You present it by playing it. Have a set of speakers, everybody sits down like this, you sit and watch a pair of speakers. Because, no, the idea is, just as Pythagoras, the legend is Pythagoras, who came up with this, it's supposed to come from a Greek word. When he, you know Pythagoras? You know this guy had a theorem?
Yeah.
What does it say? Something square.
Square.
Oh, right, a mathematician, okay. So, Pythagoras, legend says he taught his students behind a veil, because he said, if you see me, you'll be distracted. So actually, if you really want to have an acousmatic, we should have a veil now and you don't see me, or I talk from behind the door. But the key elements of acousmatic music is that it might contain melody, harmony, rhythm, and meter. It might, or it might not. Because it wants to focus on timbre and spectrum, meaning how the nature of the sound is, the feeling of the sound, the shape of it in your ear, the sounds of music. It could have sounds of musical instruments, not necessarily played as musical instruments. It could be, you could be taking a violin string and hammering it, or you might be taking a piano and bowing it. You could take voice, things that people say, but you could twist it around. You could take electronically generated sound, which was, wow, in the 1960s, you needed big transistors and valves, and nowadays you have this, my trusty Lenovo. Or field recordings where you would go out with something about in the 60s, about 20 times the size of this zoom, and you go and record things in the outside world. And now you use your iPhone. So these are the things you would hear in acousmatic music. So let's hear some examples, because talking about this is really boring. This is Bermud Parmigiani. Can I get any louder? This is Dennis Smalley. I'm keeping all the clips really short because not everybody is used to this. So, right? I've had some wonderful experiences with I've had wonderful experiences attending electroacoustic performances. And an acousmatic performance is one where literally there should be no performance. Okay, over time this has been diluted somewhat. But when I was studying in Boston and I was doing my MBA and Masters in MIS, I also took the opportunity to do 2 semesters of electronic music at the School for the Arts and got to attend a lot of electroacoustic performances. Amazing. And just nice, when we came back to Singapore, the International Computer Music Conference was in Singapore and it was at NUS. So I stayed the whole week in the UCC theater, totally pitch dark with speakers. It was amazing. So you have, sometimes it's not just 2 speakers, sometimes it could be 8 speakers because the technology is available. But basically, you are there to absorb the music. And so by the nature of this, you will understand that there are not many videos on YouTube which basically show a pair of speakers. Right? Somehow, people did not find it in them to record much of this. If you can help me to find, I will be most grateful, because those were great experiences, but those were the days before I had cheap video recording, and also it was not polite because it would be bootlegging. So the closest I can show you would be probably this. See the speakers? This is Endolith at the ICMC. Okay, this is at University of Concord, where they have a laptop orchestra. So what do you notice from there? There isn't the virtuoso kind of instrumental playing that we are used to in other forms of music. And there are benefits of this, because I did put them somewhere. Yeah. There are benefits. Okay. So acousmatic music has, over the years, has had parallels drawn with things like EDM. EDM is intelligent dance music, which is a form of abstract electronic music, which actually unconsciously takes elements, because EDM might contain melody or might not. They tend to focus on timbre and spectrum. They sometimes have sounds of musical instruments, voice, electronically generated sound, and sometimes they have few recordings, processed audio. Sounds like the description of acousmatic music. Even though 99% of IDM musicians have actually not heard Schaeffer or Stockhausen or all the Acousmatic. So interestingly, from a different background, which is techno from Detroit, they actually developed this IDM. So IDM, one example is the Orb. So here we have two examples of IDM. The first one is the Orb, and would you agree that some elements of it which sound like the earlier ones, and also the stage is all dark, you can't see the two musicians, so there is an element of you are not watching a performance. The second one has become more like a conventional performance, even though you can see the performer really doesn't want to be there, he's just got his head down. Right, he's grimacing into his laptop. But now the crowd is screaming. Wow. So IDM, there are similarities and there's also differences. IDM sometimes has more melodies and beats, and IDM shows are more likely to have visuals and live performance. This is where we see that actually the acousmatic music has not moved into the mainstream. Actually, for that matter, neither is IDM. But there are some elements of it that can still be taken. Now, why is it that we want to see performers? Why do we want to see performers perform? There's been research done into this that the movement in performance is very important. Kurosawa, not the famous Kurosawa, is an academic called Kurosawa, said it provides musical narrative and emotional information. This researcher actually did a study of the chorus, many videos of the chorus performing, and derived that, yes, the chorus physical movements provide emotional information. Another researcher, Jane Davidson, did a lot of research, including research into Annie Lennox and Robbie Williams, and her research says that sometimes it's for the artist to communicate an expressive intention. You lean forward to say, I'm making this louder, or you wave your hands to count time, or you might be communicating participation, as in so that everybody comes in for the chorus. And sometimes it presents information about the performer's personality. So if you see the sad face, and you know, I'm sad, this is a really sad song, my heart is broken, right? You're smiling, I'm really happy. So that's where the artist wants to have physical performance. What about the audience? Interestingly, research also shows that we associate movement with performance quality, and it even changes our perception of timbre, loudness, and other things. So studies have actually been conducted with pianists who played with full expression and pianists who played with no expression, playing what was acoustically the same piece of music. But the audience always feels that the one with the physical expression sounds more expressive. It's a psychological thing. I'm going to show you an example of Glenn Gould. Glenn Gould, excellent pianist. But seriously, if you know your physics, 90% of that hand movement is not necessary to produce that music, okay? Just watch his hand movement and think about this. Right? So what is that left hand doing? There is nothing in the piano that responds to his left hand. But the audience is responding because you can feel him holding the music in the left hand. So that's the beauty of it. Okay. So despite this, there are still benefits in acousmatic listening. Okay, so what were the benefits? First, it's supposed to be independent of the visual domain. So you can free your mental images and creative forms of imagination. For certain kinds of sound, it can, if it's meant to evoke your imagination, you really focus and your mind will then make the picture in your mind. This is very challenging in the modern world where we're so used to having everything come towards us right at 150 frames a second. I know it's already 25, but you know, doesn't it feel like that? We are so used to having so much input all the time. To suddenly sit in a room that's dark with just speakers is like, whoa, I can't take it. I actually have to imagine. Right? I actually do imagination exercises with some with a class that I had, a group of teens. I asked them to imagine themselves in a particular passage. After I'd finished it, there were a fair number that I can't imagine anything. It's quite frightening that we are maybe losing this ability. So acousmatic can help. The second one is that, as Schaeffer himself said in 1966, sometimes we are often surprised, often uncertain, discover much of what we thought we were hearing is reality only seen and explained by the content. So now we've, in certain kinds of sound or music, where we can hear it without the distraction, we are actually able to appreciate it even more. Which then brings me, and this is no logical segue, to electronic dance music. I couldn't think of a logical segue, I just threw it in. The reason why I thought that there might be some remote link is because of this Tumblr post. Now, remember all those wonderful blogs and that? Tumblr. Tumblr is where one particular artist lives. His name is Dead Mouse. You do not pronounce it Dead Mouse 5. Okay, it's Dead Mouse. Very established, very popular artist, electronic dance music artist, who in 2011, when he was interviewed by Rolling Stone magazine, said, "We all press play." And after that, went on to elaborate on his blog, "We all press play, it's no secret. In a live performance of EDM, it's all pre-programmed. All the work," he says, "goes into preparing the thing before." Right? Like, that's why an electronic musician spends hours and hours, as Ivan has spent hours and hours working on the music somewhere else. When he comes here, there is no point in him replicating what is it, because it's already done. He spent the effort there. You are here to hear what he has completed. And that's what Dead Mouse is saying. Why are you asking for a live version of music when it was never live? It was actually pre-programmed instrument by instrument. And that's the beauty of it, if you can appreciate the sound, the music. And I'm going to show you an example of a Dead Mouse concert, followed by a video of a David Guetta concert. So he was actually referring to David Guetta. David Guetta is a famous EDM DJ. If you know the song Titanium, that's by David Guetta. No? "Shoot me down and I don't fall, we are titanium," something like that. I'm not going to sing. There's a reason why in my band I play keyboards, I don't sing. Yeah? So you will see that Dead Mouse really is, I have invested tons of money, he says, in the visual show. The visual show is synchronized by MIDI and SMPTE, SMPTE code. Complex technological issues to make sure that his LEDs light up, his visuals, and it's fantastic. And even the helmet on his head lights up. Right? So that even when he starts doing the Windows fail sound, it's all part of the plan. Because you can't see his hands. You can't see his fingers. Basically, he's there doing la 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 la. You could be checking email. But you are there because it's a great show. He says, that's in 2011, he says, you know, this is it, this is what you came to watch. He was disparaging people like David Guetta, who basically are there, and you watch David Guetta after that. Everybody's going, yeah, David Gatto's going, whoa. He's really not doing much, you know. Basically, he's playing a recording of something that somebody else, not even himself, recorded. There is, of course, much value in DJs. DJs select good music. DJs know how to combine good music, play good music in sequence. But why is it that in the 2010s, people began to demand that the DJs must also go whoop, 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 right? There's some strange disconnect. So let me show you Deadmau5 followed by David Guetta. Deadmau5. This is David Guetta. What is he doing? He's turning one knob. What an artist. One knob. One knob. And when the melody plays, no hands. That's the beauty of EDM DJing. So that is, so it then raises the question, could EDM actually be appreciated as an acousmatic performance? Because you see, the techniques of the classical and pop musicians are visible. When you have a classical performance, see Glenn Gould, you know his hands, you can see his whole body. Yeah, you know the technical thing is there. Or you see a pop band, everybody's playing, you can see whether they're playing or not. But for electronic musicians, it's hidden. You do it before. You spend a lot of effort. Look at Deadmau5, a lot of effort went into that show. Every show he does that same Windows fail thing. And the audience still goes nuts. Right? It's the same trick. Right, but the thing is that sound heard without seeing a source makes people uncomfortable. In research, sure. Okay, so what does today's audience want? You see, Calvin Harris, another prominent EDM artist, said in response to Deadmau5, in a club you want to hear the produced piece of music, you want to hear it as good as it can sound, right? That's what he thinks. But if you watch the Grammy Awards 2012, when David Guetta performs, he's got Lil Wayne and Chris Brown in front performing. Why? Because the mass market is not used to seeing a DJ. At a festival, he can go do, but on TV, it was not the bigger market was not ready for it. Now, to make things even more complicated, last year, Deadmau5 released another blog post where he says, here's what I don't get. With all the resources you have attained in the past 8 years of getting to where you are, would it kill you to be able to add some sort of modularity beyond putting a fist in the air, telling people to make some noise, and playing the top line on an invisible keyboard in the air to show the crowd, hey everybody, the lead goes here, watch my hand. He goes, do, do, do. What is this guy saying? It's too many people copy him. a recognition that there is a place for actual playing, that there are musicians, and in fact he had been slammed when the earlier post came out that, hey, you forgot there's an entire scene of people who are playing electronic music live, right? I'm going to show you examples in a while. But the problem then for the EDM DJ or musician today is this. See, in the past, a DJ only had to play the music and play it well. But now you're criticized for appearing to play a pre-planned set list. Because you're not reading the crowd. You're not feeling the people. There's this thing called Serato Face. Serato is the name of a popular software for mixing. Serato Face is... you're constantly looking at the screen. You're not looking up. Why is that a problem? The other one is the DJ Jesus pose. You know what the Jesus pose is? All the DJs go like that. And you wish you could crucify them. Okay? So one example of the extent to which it goes, I want to show you an example of Skrillex, who is another world-class performer, playing a DJ set. But look carefully, technically, at the amount of motion he is putting in and ask yourself, how much of his motion is actually affecting the music which is being played? How much of the music is in fact dependent on the motion that he's making? So if you notice, when the music switches to the loud part, right, bubu-di-chak-ka, bubu-di-chak-chak, right, what is the amazing thing that he has done? He has pressed another button to play a different song, then bounce up and down, which is entertaining. And Skrillex works very hard to produce music which can be put together like that. But should he have to? Is the question. Or should electronic musicians feel that they have to do this to do what Skrillex is doing? So that's the question I want to ask. Because these are questions that, as while I'm teaching the electronic music lab, from year to year, do we really need to do that? It's one thing if you are standing in front of 50,000 people at Ultra Music Festival and you do like this and everybody goes, yeah, they bounce up and down. It's different when you have five of your friends in the audience and you go like this and they all go, huh? You feel very moody, you know? Yeah. So, you think, So, the other way to look at it is that there are people who are what we call EDM rock stars. And they can patch modular synthesizers live. We recently had the EML 30th anniversary festival, and we had the people from the SG, the modular synth group, and wow, patches, amazing stuff, live, amazing stuff. Or you can sing live, or you can play instruments live on top, or you could live code. I understand somebody live coded, right? Or you can do finger drumming. So, show you some examples. This is Arab music. Was that scary or what? Thank you. In fact, the dance music experience has evolved. If you look at the 70s and 80s, people went to a dance party and they didn't look at the DJ. They danced with one another. What a novel concept. Just to remind you what it's like. Whereas today, if you see the EDM concert, they're all facing front. They're not looking at each other. You have no more dance partner. Even the concept of a dance partner seems something so anachronistic. So look at this example.
Studio 54 was Sodom and Gomorrah with a disco beat. A place where celebrities and civilians alike leveled in unrestrained debauchery.
I would dance the drum if I have. Might be out the ground with some cigarette.
We'll take you to a different time.
See, they're dancing with one another on the other hand. They dancing with one another. Yeah, they're dancing with the DJ, exactly. So okay, so even acousmatic music performances have evolved. If you go and check and see what people are doing now, you will find
the reaction is always the same.
A lot more visuals. This is a silence festival. This is ICMC. A lot more live performance. So, what does it mean for acousmatic listening? I think there's still a place for acousmatic listening and acousmatic listening of dance music, but it has to be consciously created because it's going to be counterculture. The culture now is everybody faces the DJ or faces the musician. Is it possible to create a concert where the music is played, but interesting, you know, it's worth a try. But I realized that both the classical and dance electronic music appear to be incorporating more visuals and live elements. The whole, all the ICMC footage that I was going through there, wow, what happened to the sitting in front of the speakers? I missed those days. So electronic musicians seeking wider appeal need to explore more visuals and live elements. That's what it says to me, my conclusion. And what's the opportunities for MusicTech, since we are a MusicTech group? I invite you to collaborate with musicians, because musicians who need to perform live need to go beyond the instruments that we have now. The pads were a wonderful thing, because pads are, they don't require you to be familiar with the black and white keys. They are a total new thing that you can create your own world. You can create, you can assign whatever you want in software. What's beyond that? Is there something beyond pads? So if there are makers who can build cool musical instruments and controllers, and it doesn't even have to be all hardware, because you can virtualize it, there are so many touch surfaces available. I will show you to end off.
The reaction is always the same. First of all, they
future of DJ.
Well, I've been a DJ for 20 years. My name is Alan Smithson. I'm the CEO and co-founder of Smithson Martin. We make the emulator, the world's most advanced DJ system. My parents always wanted me to be a doctor, so I went through and got a degree in molecular biology and applied for med school. And
this is the lead instrument.
I
And the last one is our very own electronic music lab. This is from my electronic music lab, using the Wii. So to show you that there's hardware you can make, there's software you can make, and there is equipment in the world which is already available, which you can customize. Like my colleagues at the lab have used, we have been used. So I invite you, the music tech community, work with musicians. We have, okay, I have a lab full of musicians who are ready to do stuff with you. Just let's do it. Thank you. That was a custom built in Max for Life that my colleague did using a remote. Yeah, there are several Bluetooth implementations that are available, open source. He customized one of them. Basically, it's a matter of mapping it to what you want to play. Play notes, or play pitch, or play whatever. Anybody here are makers? Interested in making? Yeah? Making something that we'll be happy to try it out. Or something you want to code? Any coders? You want to code? Yeah? Well, you know, I mean, it's a silly question. Right? Any makers, any coders? I'm just asking. But yeah. Please do step up. Yeah. Evan, yeah.
Just a comment and a question. The comment is, I think we're all fed on the diet of performances. Mm. Look at work presentations. Try presenting without PowerPoint.
Yeah.
So the question is, the last part you said, you issue an open call for collaboration. So could you give a specific example? How exactly you would like the community to collaborate?
If you've invented something or you're developing something, and you would like a guinea pig to try it out, a tester, to try it out in a musical setting.
So it has to be hardware?
It could be hardware, it could be code, if you can come. Like my colleague there was doing the Wii, he also coded an algorithmic interface in Ableton, which is triggered off this, so that it will play music infinitely. He likes trance, so he created an algorithm for trance. So it just generates trance music. Yeah. So you got software, you got hardware. Yeah. Happy to. Well, if you want to come and visit, we are there most Saturdays. Drop us a line to make sure that we didn't move for the day or went for lunch or something. So we are open for you to come and visit. If you want to get involved in performance, then of course we'll have to induct you in through our training and everything. And then, yeah, we'll see where it goes from there. But we're happy to visit that, have visitors all the time. And you can speak to Brian. Brian is from the Electronic Music Lab. Sorry, yeah?
Yeah, the DJ, I'm not a music tech, I just came up because I'm interested.
Great.
But I know DJ, I'm from England, and I know DJs in England. And I loved your presentation because it covered a lot of areas I've been to events and continents. And what you seem to explain what's happening. Now, what I've seen today is that you had three different types of Jesus. You had the Jesus, you had that
Serato face, yeah.
And is it that, you know, like in classical music, where you have a conductor and they have an orchestra, they rehearse the orchestra, and the orchestra is performing something that was prepared before. Well, the electronic DJ seems to be doing the same thing. So it seems to me that the some of those DJs are, in a way, conducting the response of the crowd to behave in a certain way to something that they've prepared beforehand. Is that?
That's very true. That is a very good perspective, because then we are talking about not conducting the music, because the music isn't really changing when they raise their hands, but the audience is changing. Yes. So yes. So as a performance, as an entertainment, it is actually amazing. I mean, 40,000 people can't be wrong.
Yeah.
That's a good perspective. Yes.
Yeah. So I'll go back and I'll tell them
that they are. Yes. Basically, they are the conductor of a 40,000 strong orchestra.
Yeah.
So it's a cult, not a concert.
Yeah, but then you could say that classical music is a cult. So it's, I think it looks like it's gone in like a, it's going in a circle, it's evolving.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
If you describe a cult as people who all wear the same kind of clothes, going to the same kind of place, and exhibiting the same kind of behavior, and acknowledging a person right at the front of the, it could be classical music, could be EDM. Yeah. Great.
Any more questions? You're going to give us a performance, or?
I'm going to jam a little while.
All right.
This is. See, the fun thing with pads, it can make any sound. That was Warp Drive, and basically there are different loops and different sounds that are being triggered. Play another piece called Quantum. So that works best if you don't look at me at all, okay? Okay, the last piece I will play for the day, and after that, you are welcome to come up actually and play with this stuff as well. Okay. So this piece, I'm actually taking found recording, a field recording, and a field recording of a musician whom I met on the weekend and who was expressing how he felt about his electronic music and performing. And I thought, hey, Brian, you know who? You were there when I actually made the field recording. It's not Brian, somebody else. So what he said was, well, you see.
Thank you. music, music, so much. Sometimes I wish that I don't need to be up. Sometimes I wish that I don't need to be up there performing it.
This is a Launchpad. Yeah. The Launchpad, as mentioned in the title, is this is the mini version.
Yeah. Are you playing samples on that?
Yeah.
I enjoy music so much.
The thing is triggering off.
So much, and I make it danceable. Sometimes I wish that I don't need to be up there performing it out so that I can be with the audience enjoying it.
How do you remember which note you assign which?
Sometimes I don't.
I mean, there's no indication there, it's not a C key, it's a black key. Or there is a note.
Cheat sheet.
You can always put stickers, like smiley face.
Yeah, I can put smiley face also, yeah.
Because whenever they show the video, it's like, wow, this could go in the trigger.
Those guys practice for hours.
Oh, yeah.
They practice for hours. So, you know, you cannot play, you don't see me doing the guy that. I play all slow ones, right? Think I must be realistic.
How's the latency in there?
How's the latency? I think you have to feel it. Yeah, you have to come and feel. Come ahead, come along and feel it. Then you can express. Because my threshold for latency is a bit, I'm a bit okay with it. Some people are more accurate than me. Latency, for those who are not sure, is that when I press, how long does it take for the sound? It should take about 19 milliseconds. For those of you who are purists and you accept nothing below 10 milliseconds, I don't know. What can I do?
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.